just using map and syntactic sugar for map and flat map. And common use cases, for example, future or option or things like that. But if you ever try to have an option inside a future or something like that, and you try to use a for comprehension for that, you will have probably noticed that this is really cumbersome, and that you would need nested for comprehension stuff like that. And this is a problem. But fortunately, there are some ways to fix this problem. And our next speaker, Harry, is going to show how he will solve this problem with Monad stacks. And he will also probably have some code which shows before and after. So yeah, this is basically, this is for you if you have options inside futures. So please welcome Harry.
Okay, so I guess we all recognize this character, the hardcore functional programmer, who just wants to do everything functionally and is very dogmatic. The anti-functional programming manager, whenever you suggest to import cats or scalas in your code base, he goes crazy. And the enthusiastic functional programming beginner who writes the free monad. Okay, as a reference, please keep in mind that given a choice of solution, pick the least powerful solution capable of solving your problem. This is from an excellent blog of Li Hao-Yi. Strategic Scala style, principle of least power. So what's the problem? The problem is embedded maps, flat maps, and pattern matching. This typical play framework code. So what does this code? It only does four things. Parse the request as JSON, save the user from JSON, save the user in the database, and return user as JSON. So let's see it again. Okay, so here it parses the body as a JSON and then pattern match. If it's null, it logs the error and returns an unprocessable entity. If there is some JSON, it parses the JSON as a user. So it pattern match, I guess, if it's correct. It saves the user in the database. And if it's the operation goes correct, it returns the user as a JSON. If it doesn't correct, it returns internal server error, so it could write the user in the database. And here we are in the second pattern matching. I lost it. So, yeah, you all get the problem with this code. So why is the code that long? Because it's a penalty of using future and option. We use future for asynchronicity and option for elimination of nil pointer exception. Is there a way to reduce this penalty? Yes, we can use for comprehension. So from basic Scala book, programming Scala by Odesky and Venice, for comprehensions can be translated into applications of the high order function map, flat map, and with filter, and this can go the other way also. So I searched the internet, if I found this blog post by Sinisa Luk, so I just stole some code from there. So let's say we have a load item from order to future of item, a purchase item, it's a function from item to future of purchase to purchase result, and log purchase, a function of purchase result to future of log result. So one way to have a result is to put them everything in flat map, or we can write for comprehensions. So we have a loaded order, which is order service load order. We have a loaded item, which is item service dot load item of loaded order, and so on. So we have a problem. We cannot use for comprehensions in future of option. Before I suggest some solution, I would like to suggest that either of error of A is a better option of A, because we can have semantics in error. So in case of a null, we don't know what's wrong, but in case of either of error of A, we can have really better semantics. So if you try to type error in IntelliJ, I think you get more than 20 error classes from different kind of libraries. So to have, how to say, a better namespace, let's define our error as erratum, which is just Latin for error. So yeah, I would like to mention that I always try to use unique names just for namespace, just for practical reasons. So there is no conflict. So what does our customer does? Nothing fancy. It is a case class of a status and a message, a string message. And has just one function method that returns a result. And in its companion object there are some convenient factory methods. So let's define our basic type. It's a feature of either of an atom or base. Base can be anything, can be an integer, a unit, a string. I would suggest four different possible solutions: a monad, monad transformers, free monad, an effects library. The problem is that this talk is too short to have some code about effects library, so I'm using it only as a reference. And there are very excellent talks in YouTube where you can search it and check more about effects library. So a monad is a generalized effect composition library. But there are some warnings. The monad produced by M is not guaranteed to be a lawful monad, and it's not recommended for real work. Yeah, at least that's what the readme of the library says. So, using this library, we define our monad stack, which is a future of either of Eratum, and finally, it's the base. So how do we put the values into the effect stack? We use three methods, three functions: point, liftM, and wrap. So let's check what are the possible types that we could have by calling APIs or other libraries. So it can be base, or it can be just a string, or an integer, or a unit. It can be either of error or base, can be future of base, and can be future of either of error or base. So when we have a base, we use point. When we have either of error or base or future of base, we use lift. And when we have our full monad, future of either of error of base, so we can use wrap. It's that simple. So this spaghetti code can become like this. We just pass the request. We create the user from JSON, we save in the database, and we debug the error. Okay, I'm gonna show you what basically the code is not important, just the signature. So parse request takes a request, return an either of error or JSON. JSON takes a JSON and returns an either of error or the value that we provide with the implicit reads. Save, it can be anything from reactive Mongo or Slick. In that case, just a hard-coded value. Save E is just a transformation of the previous save that returns future of either of error of your user. And stack to result is just a helper function that takes the future of either of error or A and returns the future of result. So let's look at better. What we are doing, a for comprehension inside the NEM monad, where first we take a JSON, a JS value, and we lift it to the monad. We parse and we create from the JSON the user. Again, we lift the monad. We save the user and wrap it. We put again the monad. And we debug, and then we take the result and we print it. So this looks a lot like the pseudocode, a lot more. But then it's not recommended to use it in production. So let's use monad transformers to have a similar code. So for those of you who don't know what a monad transformer is, the simplest way to think of it is that if you have a future of either of error, so you can have a monad transformer, so these things just go the other way around, and these are equivalent. It's that simple. I mean,
nothing fancier than that. The only thing you should try to remember is that this change position. So in either T, of future, of error, of base, is basically a future of either
of error or base. And we can go from one type to the other. So let's say we have a future of either of error or base. So we can have the Armona transformer by either T from either. And if we have a monotransformer of future of error of base, we can take its value and have a future of either of error or base. So the advantage is that we can use for comprehension in a monotransformer. But first, extension methods. Extension methods are simple scala, it's not a library, it's nothing. So if we have a function from A to B, and we want to call a second function on A, we can have this result with implicit classes. So we can say we have an implicit class reach A that takes an argument, an A, and we define a method that is actually the first function called, so those two are equivalent. So let's define extension methods for all the different types. Okay, when we have base, we use purity. So we create an implicit class. The important thing in order to read the code, especially for the beginners, is the name of the class is irrelevant. We don't care, it just has to be unique. So we just care about the argument of the implicit class and just the name of the function, purity, and the return type. So when we have an either of error base or a future of base, we use liftT. Again, we define an extension method for either of error of base. We define an implicit class that takes an argument neither of error of B, and it has one method, liftT, that returns the monotransformer. Yeah, this is the same example for the future of base. Again, an implicit class that creates a method. So when we have future of either of error of base, we use RapidT, and here is its definition, it's the code. So our basic type is still future of either of error of B, and by porting the previous implicit class in scope, we have almost the same code as before. The only difference, because of namespace, is I named the lift, wrap, and cure and point methods a bit different. And instead of calling run, I think right now we are using value. So again, the code does just four things. Parse the request at JSON, create the user from JSON, save the user in database, and returns the user as JSON. Okay, why extension methods? In my opinion, they produce much more cleaner code, and a lot of plumbing, a lot of strange code can be done only once. And also, in my opinion, it is faster when you are writing in your IDE or your. It is faster to just write, call your API, call your libraries, and then just say dot something instead of going back and trying to wrap it. So that's how the code would look like without extension methods. So we need to wrap all our calls from the libraries inside an either T method. And also we can have all sort of helper methods. So let's say we have an API that returns an option. So we can create an implicit class that takes a parameter takes an argument of an option and just write once the code. Yeah, let's say we have an API that calls and returns either a throw apple of B. Then you can write just once an implicit class converter and just use that. So free monads. Free monads is a very big topic, and I guess it's somehow difficult for me to explain it in just 10 minutes. But if you keep it somehow abstract and you use this cookbook, it's pretty straightforward. So we create an ADD representing the algebra. We free the ADD, I would add with extension methods. We build a program and write an interpreter for the program. This is the algebra, it's just an algebraic data type, a sealed trait of algebra with a generic type A. We have a case class from base that takes a class argument, just an A, a base type. We have a case class from either that takes as argument either of error or A. We have a case class from future that takes future of A. And we have a case class from future either that takes a future of either of error. So just the four basic types we have, we just define it as an algebraic data types with sealed trait and case classes. We define an interpreter, which is a natural transformation from algebra to either T, to a monotransformer. Yeah, I understand that, especially for the people who don't know what a natural transformation is, this might be, how to say, a bit strange, but it's nothing more than just a pattern matching. So we just provide a constructor and then pattern match against the different case classes. And we also use the code, the extension method that we wrote before. More or less is this, but yeah, I don't have the time to explain it better or more. And the second step is to, the third step is to free the ADD with extensions method. So when we have a base, we use pure, and this is the implicit class. So basically just one command, free.liftf. Everything else is just lambda code to just have the different types as arguments. So when we have either of error of base or future of base, we use lift. So the code is nothing fancy. I mean, again, we just create an implicit class that takes an either of error array and just free liftf, the case class that we defined before. Again, yeah, when we have a future of either of error of base, we need to define wrap. So wrap is defined, I guess, again, as an implicit class that has just one method. And there we just lift our case class to the free monad. So we define the program. This is a play controller. It just has a type program, which is a free of algebra to A. If you see, again, it's the same for loop, almost similar. We just use our new methods, and instead of calling dot value, we call the free monad weights program fold map. So all three ways are pretty similar. Just a note, in order to compile the free monad code, you need to enable the partial unification. This is a plugin fix for partial unification. But if it is enabled, the M code does not compile. I was getting a strange error. I didn't have time to go more into that. So F is an extensible effects library that are an alternative to monotransformers for computing with effects in a functional way. I don't have time to show an example, but the idea is similar to free monad, but I strike through this sentence because the idea is similar, but the syntax is pretty different, so it's a big master and it takes time to master it. But from the tutorial of the FX library, we can see that, yeah, it's pretty similar. It creates an algebraic data type representing the grammar, free the ADT, creates smart constructors using fsend, build the program and write an interpreter for your program. So it's the basic, the same steps as it goes for free Monad. Especially for the beginners, keep in mind the cognitive load. Functional programming can create code that can be more compact and more readable. So this is the pseudocode, just for operations. This is the spaghetti Scala code, which I think it's 23 lines of code. And this is almost imperative code using 3 or 4 different alternatives. Here are the slides and the code. Thank you.
Hello? Oh, there we go. Good. The good and loud. So, I don't like spaghetti code as much as the next person. But if I make an error in my code when I have spaghetti code like that, the compile error is usually fairly readable. And I'm curious what your experience is with compile errors using these frameworks.
Okay, personally I'm using the second approach with the Monad transformer and the implicits. For me it's very clear. I mean, I'm using IntelliJ.
I need to get you in my head.
I'm using IntelliJ, and whenever I get an error, I mean, yeah, after, I don't know, 30 minutes practicing with errors, it's really clear. Like, there's the error. And usually the error is just using a wrong pure wrap or lift.
Cool. So what I'm hearing is that there's a little bit of investment in the beginning, but then it pays off because you've learned how to deal with the compile errors.
Yes, that's always the case.
Cool. Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. So you've shown several approaches. In the end, which is the one you like the most and you would recommend?
Depends on the case. I mean, in this case, I was trying to demonstrate that you don't need to import a library or something. You can just write, I don't know, 50 lines of utils, of implicit classes, and just use that. So if you are just want to handle future of option or something, I would recommend Monad transformers and implicit classes. But on the other hand, if you indeed want to create an algebra and you did indeed have a problem where you need different kind of interpreters, then you should go for free Monad. So the advantage of free Monad is that you can provide different interpreters. So let's say you have a friend of mine is working for a startup in Amsterdam. They are building some DevOps tools on top of Mesos or DCOS or something like that. I don't know a lot of details. So he's using free Monad in order, because he can have a different machines. So he can have the same code, provide different interpreters.
Thanks for the talk. What about the lawfulness of the Monad stacks that you showed to us after the M example? Because the M Monad is said to not be lawful. So yeah, in the other examples, you recreated something similar. So is it lawful or?
No, I didn't recreate anything. I'm just creating Monad transformers from the standard CATS library. So I guess it's been tested. I trust it. I trust it. I don't have a reason not to trust it.
As a follow-up to the last question, to the previous question, I would say that it's a comment. I would say that you will always, almost always, need several interpreters, because one will be for production, okay, and you will use interpretation based on your stack, okay, and another one will be for testing, okay. If you want to do testing in a purely functional way. Okay, then if you program your business logic using either F, okay, free Monad, F, or in a final Itactus style, then you can get your interpretation for production, and then you can also get an interpretation for testing.
Just add a little something on top of that. You would go by using not only monad transformers, but free monads and F, when you want to add new effects, like if you want to insert option or state in your stack, you have all sorts of code to change. With free monads, you can just compose this thing a lot more easier. Yeah.
Hello. Your algebra of free monads contains the notion of effects, and I think you are losing a bit of space for interpretation. So when you encode your algebra as an actions or some operations that do some calculations or some database interactions without the context of effect, then during interpretation, you can be like you can have more space for handling these things. And if you encode like effects into your algebra, then you have no space for that. So you know what I mean, or just to do?
The thing is that it's just a toy example to show to beginners what are the advantages of using monad transformers, free monads. That's the point of this topic. I understand. Just some sample code to show them, yeah, okay, you can write spaghetti code, but it's not that difficult to write functional code that's better.
Thank you. Any further questions?
Okay, then let's thank the speaker.